Alrighty, hello everybody. Welcome back to another Oxygen Not Included stream. This will probably be the finale of this little mini tutorial, mini series thing that's been going on. The reason it's probably going to be the finale is because there's not a whole lot else to talk about. I said at the end of the last stream that I would be working on power grids and trying to start up oil and plastic production. So that's what I've done. It took me longer than I thought it would. We are now at cycle 182. I thought I would have something to show for you guys by cycle 150, but I just barely managed to finish the power grid by that time. So let's get things moving here and I'll walk you through it. We are playing on the Terra Asteroid. If you're new to this mini-series and you're just popping in here to start with, the pips came from the printing pod. So, that's where they came from. What do we have here? Oh, now I get operating. okay, that's how it's gonna be. Yeah, I think it was cycle 151 where I finally got tired of not having my 12th duplicate and I just started reloading the autosave over and over and over again until I got a duplicate with single interest operating. It actually took, I don't remember how many, it was like 7 or 8, I know it was fewer than 10 tries, fewer than 10 reloads of the game, but I finally got a single interest operating duplicate, and they actually came with a treat of Grease Monkey, so they ended up having another +3 machinery, so they are pretty well off. Yeah. Now the game gives me one. Anyway, so we're going to take the Stasi suit, because this obsolete Great Hall layout only allows me to have a total population of 12 duplicates safely. So yeah, that's not great. You know what, I am going to leave that on sleep only. Just get that egg and get out of there. Okay, so, things we're going to be talking about today. We have the power grid that I decided to put below the base because I wasn't really doing anything else with the space. I did gravity drop the water from the last episode that was here, so that water has fallen down. I have a collected pool of water down here at the bottom of the base. And I'm actually considering gravity dropping the pool that is above the base as well, because it's going to take quite a long time for that to get out of there. And I'm at the point now where, since I am starting to make plastic, I would really like to get my permanent cooling system in place. And I think right here above the base centralized is a good spot for it. And this water is just kind of in the way. Yeah, so I'll be talking about the power grid, and the other major talking point is plastic production. So that'll be covered in this area and down at the oil biome as well. But something I noticed just prior to starting the stream is that we're out of algae. We've made it to cycle 182, but recently we ran out of algae that had already been dug up, so I just have to casually put out a small, innocent little dig order request to go get some more stuff to keep carrying on. Not to say that we are in short supply of algae, just that we don't have any on hand right this second. Okay, so let's make sure stream is live. Mark is here. Hello. No, I'm streaming. I have a window to do it in. All right, so power grid. I used to have the base's power grid divided into two halves. We had a left half and a right half, and the left three generators were supplying most of the power to the left side, and same with the right side. There were some isolated power circuits. We had a jump start system up here to get the oxygen production running. And I still have a system right here supplying power to the metal refinery and the thermal aquatuner through a limited amount of conductive wire. This will probably stay here for a little while longer because it was just easier to leave it there rather than trying to replace it. So in the meantime, the rest of the base has continued to maintain the standard gauge basic wiring. And to enable that and have enough different circuits that weren't overloaded, I ended up having to divide the base's entire power grid into four different lines. I probably could have gone away with three, but four just seemed easier at the time when I was setting it up. So we have four power distributing lines coming out of the power grid at the bottom of the base. We got one going to the kitchen, two going to the stables and the power generation slash gymnasium lights, and also the massage table and the water sieve. Line three is taking care of the industry on the top floor, the exosuit production thing, a little bit of oxygen production, and one of our two rock crushers. And then line number four is, for the moment, only taking care of the exosuits and one of the oxygen diffusers, but I think I will put these on a separate line all of their own eventually, once I go to space, and then I can have another line dedicated to the research bay. So, this, as it stands, is just serving our current needs. It is not a permanent solution. I will evolve the power grid over time, make it a bit more advanced, provide some cooling down here because the transformers run hot all the time. Like, they are constantly on and constantly producing heat. I think they actually say that they produce relatively little amount of heat. Yeah, just one DTU. That's, I think, less than what a duplicate puts out. But it's constantly putting out that heat, and it remains stationary. It's not like the duplicates who continue moving around and spreading their body heat. So, yeah, this area is getting pretty warm already. This power grid was completed at, I want to say, cycle 150, 151, something like that. And just in the last 30 cycles, we are already getting pretty toasty down here. So it's a bit concerning. I would like to seal off the room eventually and duct in some cooling air, but that'll be quite a while yet to come. So, make sure we're good on oxygen before I start going into this. All right. So the power comes from our gymnasium. I have all six manual generators connected onto a single output line, and that output line comes down here and charges two jumbo batteries. One jumbo battery would work fine because the batteries are charged and discharged simultaneously. But having extra voltage on hand, or extra joules, I should say, allows a greater buffer time for duplicates to realize that the batteries are getting low and then run back to the gymnasium to start powering them up again. So having two batteries just gives me more time to react to the batteries getting low. Then from there, they both mutually go out over the same line. It's a little bit hard to see with the green lettering there, but they both go out over the same line to the first transformer. And then this transformer basically forces the electricity in the batteries to flow into the next set of batteries, because batteries directly hooked up to each other will do nothing. They won't recognize that there's any flow required of them. So for example, if I had a battery here and a battery here and wires going between them, and let's say the left battery had charge and the right one did not, the right one would never fill up just by this one battery having charge and being hooked to it. It doesn't do anything, it doesn't care. No, please don't actually build them. I was kidding. What are you guys doing down here? Getting algae. Okay, you've done that. Please go away. This is supposed to be a sealed room. And I need to shut the door. Sorry, guys. Alright, so there's my room's airflow. I might need to turn on the air conditioning in a little while. There was a light breeze outside, but I guess we're gonna lose that. Anyway, so the transformer basically forces the electricity to flow out of one battery into another battery. That's what that is doing right there. So the electricity flows as needed into the two smart batteries, and the smart batteries are set up with a bunch of automation, which I'll talk about in a little bit more, so that they can control themselves about when they receive power and when they contribute that power back out to the rest of the base. And then from the smart batteries, when one of them is discharging out to the world along a white line as opposed to a purple line, the white discharge line goes over to a second transformer, which serves as a wire gauge step up. Basically, it's allowing the 1 kilowatt wire to safely distribute power out to 4 additional transformers without overloading the smaller basic gauge wire. So the heavy watt wire takes whatever amount of power is being drawn from the rest of the base above and pulls that power out of the second transformer into the 4 tertiary power transformers. And then each transformer sends the power out over the 4 individual circuits I already talked about. So that is what is happening. That's how the power gets distributed from one production location to multiple consumption locations. And that's a much tidier solution than what I had going on prior to this. So that's the power grid as it stands right now. Let me check on chat again, and then we'll go into the automation. Mythos is here, Vegas is here, hello! Yes, yes, yes it has. Okay, so let's watch this battery on the right side, because it seems... Yeah, I'm gonna turn on the air conditioning, sorry. Sorry for all of that noise. I was hoping this would be a quiet stream, but I misjudged my window. Alright, so it looks like both batteries are actually discharging out to the gauge step-up transformer. Now, the right side battery is going to run out of charge momentarily, and you'll be able to tell that because its little green battery charge gauge will run out, it will expire, that little last little green bar will disappear. When that happens, the right side battery will output an automation signal that is green as opposed to its current state, which is red. While it is discharging, it says it outputs red. When it becomes empty, it will output green saying, give me more juice. So basically green means, hey, I'm empty, fill me up, and red means, hey, I'm full, let me discharge. So green is saying, give me power, basically. So we can watch that happen right now. And there we go. So what that does is go through this AND gate, and I'll talk about the other input in a moment because everything's connected in one big loop. It'll go into this AND gate, and the AND gate's output will connect the input shutoff. And I don't like the word shut off because it sounds like I'm actually saying shut off, but I like to call them gates. It'll connect the input gate and disconnect the output gate. So when the battery is ready to be charged, it'll connect the input gate and the juice will flow from the standby, and it'll disconnect itself from the base's draw, because if we hook up to the second transformer while we're charging, it'll cause wire overloads on the battery transfer system. So that's why we have a 2-gate system, an input gate and an output gate for each individual smart battery. Alright, so then in conjunction with telling its own gates to flip-flop from connected to disconnected, it also outputs a green signal over this little gate, this automation bridge jumps over the wire and goes into a NOT gate, which transforms this green signal into a red signal, which interrupts the output of the second AND gate. And then what this does is force the other battery to either open or shut. And it's easier just to let it happen and see how the circuits change rather than describe them. What I've tried to do here with having two loops connected to each battery is basically it's a mutual override system. Okay, so the right battery is about to be full, it'll turn red. And then the left battery is about to get green output, saying, hey, fill me up. There we go. Now, while this is charging, the left battery has very, very slight predominance over the right battery, but there has to be some predominance somewhere. We can't just have an infinite loop because otherwise you never have a logical stability. It would always be oscillating. Reds and greens flickering back and forth to each other. So the left battery has very slight predominance over the right battery. When it is outputting a green signal, it will actually go through this bottom NOT gate and output whatever the opposite is, sending the opposite signal over to the right side's battery and overriding whatever the right battery's request is. So if the right battery is green and it's receiving an, the right battery's signal is green, it says, hey, I'm hungry, fill me up with some electricity. The left battery going through the NOT gate might be saying, no, hang on, I'm giving you a red signal to your AND gate, so just hold your horses. You're gonna have to wait your turn to be filled up because the left battery takes priority. So that's kind of what's going on here. It's just the left battery overrides the right battery, but because they are connected in a loop to each other, each battery's output is an input for the other battery, and that's mutually true. It ends up being a mutually overriding system. So what tends to happen is that you almost always have one battery charging at a time or one battery discharging at a time. Although it's more common to have both batteries discharging at a time if the load throughout the base is rather light. There we go. And so now what this has done is the left battery said, hey, I'm outputting a red signal because I'm full, I'm ready to start discharging. This ends up being a red signal out to you, which gives the right side's battery a green, saying you are fine to fill yourself up whenever you feel like you need to fill up. So you have my permission to change your bottom gate to a green. Just speed up time so you can see that in action. So both batteries are discharging, but the right battery is going to go empty first. There we go. We're at triple speed now. I just saw somebody run by again, which means I have a loose door somewhere that I need to seal. And there we go. Now left battery is charging, right battery is discharging. And there we go. So, yeah, mutual override system tries to make sure that only one battery is charging at a time, so that we always have at least one battery giving power out to the rest of the base. And what that means in functional terms for the base's operations is that you almost never have a brownout. It is extremely rare to have a brownout anywhere in the base because at some time one of these two batteries is almost always contributing power out to the distribution grid. So that's what this whole little automation system is all about. Just a mutual override system. Yeah, so that's fun. Check on chat, see if anybody has gone completely lost. Oh, okay, good. All right. So yeah, before I go any further, I do want to mention the personnel change. So last stream left off at 10 duplicates, so we now have our final two duplicates. As promised, I got somebody who is dedicated to being a doctor, and somebody else who is dedicated to being an operator. Now, in order to get the final tier of the operation tree, job tree, he has to go up through supply, but that's not a big deal. So he'll be a secondary mechatronics engineer, but his main job is just operating whatever the heck he can get his hands on because he has 14 machinery, starting out with 10, of course, because of single interest and the Grease Monkey? Yeah, Grease Monkey trait. Those two together gave him 10 machinery to start with, and he earned four more from these two nodes. And then Nisbet is doctor and also going to be a secondary artist, so that's the next place she's going to go because Ren once I decide that Ren would not become my astronaut, I decided to have him be an interim decorator until I got a more dedicated decorator to come along. So doctoring and decorating, she's pretty neutral, doesn't do a whole lot, but she is an essential function of keeping the base spirits up and making sure everybody's healthy and ready to work, both mentally and physically. So I finally have a dedicated doctor decorator on hand, and I will be training her in those roles. Everybody else is pretty well full on their job trees. I can't really give them any more job assignments right now without exceeding their morale threshold. There are some exceptions to that, but I have noticed while everybody was working down in the oil biome that a lot of time I would have fewer green bars than I did orange bars, and duplicates would rapidly rack up some stress. And because they were accumulating stress, I decided to set up a little massage clinic for them. So that's the newest addition. And of course, I had to add in two more cots because our previous barracks only had room for 10 duplicates. And I could have removed the sculptures and added in an additional cot to each room, but I kind of wanted the high decor values in there with the sculptures present. So I decided to just make another little miniature barracks for our two additional personnel. Shower, I think the shower was present in the last stream. I don't know if it was or not, but I have witnessed duplicates actually using the shower, so it's happy to see. And Wheezwort, I think the only other new thing about the base, besides the power grid and the personnel changes, is that I finally put in some conveyor rails. I put in an auto sweeper and a conveyor loader. The automation for this looks for absolutely any amount of eggs present in the room. Once it detects even one single egg, it will turn on the circuitry. The sweeper will grab whatever the egg is, dump it into the loader, and the loader will shunt it out to an adjacent room where it will no longer affect the sensor's egg count. And this egg ca or this critter sensor is also controlling the power gate for this little miniature circuit to make sure that it's not pulling wattage unnecessarily. So yeah, there's that. Looks like we have a little bit of extra polluted water here. I'm going to open up this tap a bit and let it kind of trickle feed into our thimbleweed. Although at this point we have enough thimbleweed that I'm really not concerned anymore. I think I could make quite a few more paintings if I wanted to. Yeah, we have 27 reed fibers, so I'm not terribly concerned. But given that the clean water liquid reservoir is full, and the polluted water reservoir is gradually accumulating in our little closed loop gray water system, I figure now is probably a decent time to release some of that overflow and help the thimbleweed grow, just for keeping the fluid levels from overflowing, because you don't want to have backed up toilets. Is there anything else aside from rearranging the mushrooms? That took a while. If you guys haven't heard me rant about it before, trying to change mushroom farm tile locations is kind of a pain because the slime that sits in the tile contains a heck of a lot of slime lung. And the only way to safely remove these tiles is to starve the mushrooms. Basically, you lock the doors or prevent access to the room. You lock all of the doors and you prevent your farmers from being able to go into the room and fertilize the mushrooms with more slime. By preventing them from fertilizing the mushrooms, the slime that is already in those tiles eventually gets consumed by the mushrooms there. And once the slime is down to something like a few milligrams or a few micrograms, the slime lung germ count eventually gradually dies off. And you can actually accelerate that die-off by waiting for an autosave and then just reloading the autosave. And then it'll recognize, well, hey, we have so few kilograms in here, we're down to micrograms or something. The germ count is essentially negligible, and you'll see like a 100 factor or a couple of magnitudes of drop in the germ count just by reloading an autosave after they're already down to that small mass amount. So a little bit handy acceleration to get rid of that. But anyway, once the mushrooms are finally starved and you are ready to dismantle the tiles or simply move the mushrooms to another tile, then you want to lock all of your other doors that would allow the duplicates to go out and get more slime sitting in storage areas. So you lock their access to prevent them from going to get more slime, and then you unlock all of these doors so that the farmers can go in and uproot the mushrooms and dismantle the farm tiles. And then that's how you safely get rid of a germy, slime lung laden farm tile, is to just starve them of slime. So yeah, that's it. Took me a while to move all the stuff around, but I finally have everything pretty much where I want it. The mushrooms are in a relatively stable carbon dioxide environment, and although that will change as soon as we start repressurizing the base with oxygen above, but for now they're in a pretty stable environment. I have enough mushrooms to keep the duplicates more or less fed continuously. Put that over there. I just copied the setting so we have two grills ready and able to go preparing mushrooms. Yeah, so food situation got improved, and I think that is everything for inside the base. I think those are all the changes to the inside of the base. Outside the base, I added a couple more Atmosuit docks, so we now have 6 here instead of the previous 4, and I finally got the second stable up and running, and I'm trying to get their populations to maximum capacity. In fact, I'm seeing that we have 8 here and 7 here, so you have to go to this one next. Let's wrangle you and move you over there. It should just be one more egg that's waiting to actually incubate to a full hatch status. And once that final egg hits its incubate status, because I think I have another elderly... Yeah, I have another elderly duplicate in there, so I'm... Not elderly duplicate, elderly hatch that I'm getting ready to replace in the near future. So once this final egg hatches, I can finally go back to commanding the egg drops to go into a holding location that will automatically crack the eggs, and we can get more omelets out of them. Yeah, so food variety is pretty good in the base. We have omelets, we have mushrooms, we have a few other things. Gristleberry from naturally growing bristle blossoms, and a few other things. So food's pretty good. Before I go and talk about the oil, let me talk about this situation up here, where the thermal aqua tuner is cooling down both the metal refinery's coolant and also is now cooling down our oxygen production room for the exosuits. So you may remember from last stream, I finally built this right at the end of the stream. We have a dedicated oxygen supply line going down to do nothing but power the exosuits, so the exosuits constantly have ready and available oxygen. But I lamented a bit about whether or not it would be safe to try to keep this room cool when its main source of cooling comes from one of the biggest heat producers in the base, which is the metal refinery. I had some hesitation about that, some trepidation, but it ended up being unfounded because as long as you are relatively slow in how much metal you refine, or how, not how much, but how often you refine the metal, the thermal aqua tuner is actually able to do a pretty good job of keeping up with your production demands, and it keeps the reservoir's coolant at a pretty cool temperature, cool enough that you can safely regulate the not very often active oxygen production room, because again, the only thing this oxygen production room is supplying are the exosuits. But if that were to change, if I were to branch off this oxygen line into the base, for example, then the room would be active much more often, and it would require a lot more heat to be dissipated from it, and then I think I might be in trouble by having a temperature, a greatly fluctuating temperature cooling system going into here. But for now, so long as we have that dedicated oxygen supply going to only the exosuits, where the duplicates don't really care what the oxygen temperature is inside the exosuit proper, we're pretty well okay using that limited capacity cooling system. So it's done pretty well so far. Just going slow with the metal production, everybody's pretty happy. More skill points. Is that... It is Rowan. Good job, Rowan. Thank you. And I'm actually going to have you do... operating as a high priority for you. Okay. So yeah, that was just a small change from last time. I got it set up in the last stream, but I didn't actually connect it and start using it. So I just wanted to show you that it is actually working. And speaking of things that are surprisingly working, I have left the liquid pump connected as a sort of experiment, because ordinarily when you have extra draw on the line that exceeds the 800 watt power production capacity of the hydrogen generator, you end up exhausting your battery a lot more frequently, and you exceed what the hydrogen generator is capable of doing for power generation, which makes the generator itself become very thirsty and go through your stored up hydrogen very quickly, and then you end up running out of hydrogen. So, ordinarily, I have the liquid pump on a completely different circuit from the oxygen production room, but this time I left it connected to the oxygen production room circuit as an experiment just to see what would happen. And I have actually been pretty surprised that it has managed to maintain not only charge but also continue accumulating hydrogen. We actually have a pretty good amount of hydrogen in here now. So it seems to work. I'm not going to trust that that will always be the case, but in this particular situation where the oxygen production room in question is running at limited capacity, it seems to do all right. It doesn't suck up a whole lot of water very quickly, so the pump is only going to actually become active and pump up some amount of fresh water when the tile up where this little green arrow is located becomes empty. So in the next little water push, you'll see it will go down to zero, and then quickly the pump will turn on and refill it to 10 kilograms of water, and then it'll go dormant while that one tile is draining forward along the pipe in the little tiny micro bubbles that you'll see move once in a while. So until this tile, this behind the green arrow that I'm pointing at, until that tile of piping becomes empty, the pump is basically dormant. It's idle. It's not consuming power. So during that interim, the hydrogen generator is not having to waste power on keeping the pump active, which is quite nice. So I think that is why we're able to get away with it, but I would not trust that to be the case in a more active system where the electrolyzer is running more often, or we have multiple electrolyzers supplying oxygen to a much larger consumption zone, like the entire base itself. For now, the entire base is still dependent on algae, but that will quickly, or not quickly, it'll very soon become no longer the case that we can sustain ourselves in algae, and I will have to build a second oxygen production room just to supply power, sorry, just to supply oxygen to the base. So, yeah, everything's working for now, but I don't trust that will be the case for much longer. That's what I wanted to say about that. All right, let's talk oil. Eggs. Maybe it's Christmas. I don't have much automation in the base, actually. Very little, in fact. Yeah, just the critter sensors. This is not even being used. This is just a basic timer. It's on or off at certain times of the day. And this is really the only complicated thing I have in here. For now. All right, let's talk oil. There are four machines, well, three or four machines that will usually be built concurrently to take advantage of the presence of crude oil and the industry that comes along with it. The pump will distribute the crude oil up to where it is first needed, which is going into the oil refinery. The oil refinery will take the crude oil, which are the black dots, and it will turn the black dots into yellow dots, which is an output of petroleum. So the oil refinery will output petroleum. Petroleum can be used in several different places. One of them being one of them being more advanced rocket engines, which you don't have to worry about for quite some time. But the earliest places where you'll probably use it are the polymer press, which turns the petroleum into plastic. And plastic is useful for quite a few things, not least of which being the steam turbine, which we'll use in our permanent cooling solution. And also, what I really like to use it for are the high pressure gas vents. So you can output any amount of pressure, well, up to 20 kilograms. You can output overpressurized gases, or you can output gas into an overpressurized zone, is what I'm trying to say. So it gives you much more flexibility about where you force air to be deposited into the surrounding ambient environment. So far we have oil refinery and polymer press, and then one of the byproducts of the oil refinery is natural gas. And the natural gas, of course, can be consumed in the natural gas generator. Now, the natural gas generator outputs carbon dioxide as its byproduct, and the polymer press also outputs carbon dioxide as its byproduct, along with a little bit of steam, which is kind of annoying, but I'll talk about that separately. So you have two sources of carbon dioxide. So in order to maintain that, you have to rely on a few different, or at least one solution out of three different possibilities. One possibility being the algae terrariums, which scrub a little bit of carbon dioxide. The slicksters, which will consume a heck of a lot of carbon dioxide, so much so that you might accidentally depressurize your lower zones of your base. Or you can go for the safe middle ground, which is a carbon skimmer, which can be controlled with automation and all sorts of sensors that dictate when this thing becomes active, or you can just, have a duplicate come by and manually flick a switch. So the carbon skimmer, I think, is the safest option, but it does require power and it does require a little bit of plumbing, but those aren't really big deals once you have all the infrastructure set up that you would actually need those things. So, liquid pump to the oil refinery. From the oil refinery over to the polymer press. These two things have different gas byproducts. The natural gas generator can take care of one of those byproducts, and the carbon skimmer can take care of the other byproduct. You kind of have to build all those machines sort of at the same time in order to safely take care of your oil industry. Pumping the oil from the very hot bottom oil biome up to a place where it can actually be used on a frequent basis by your duplicants is a bit of a challenge. When I was coming down here to the oil biome, I had to actually thread my ladders through multiple different pockets of gases that I did not want to have accidentally released into the environment. So the ladders were not straight for very long. I had to take a very zigzagged route to get down here. You could probably see that a little bit better with the by following the black carbon dioxide boxy line. So that's where my ladders are. And because threading my way through different gas pockets was a little bit tricky at times, I decided to only leave the passageway just one tile wide. And having it be only one tile wide becomes very difficult when you have to manage those multiple gas byproducts of the machineries I was talking about. Machines, whatever. So what I decided to do was have the pump send the oil out along a single narrow line all the way up back along the ladder route, all the way up to a separate oil industry room, which is much closer to the base, and the duplicates can walk over there very quickly, very easily, and actually use the machines that are in here and get stuff accomplished without having to spend hours and hours and hours out of their daily cycle going all the way down to the oil biome and trying to process the oil in situ. So that was a decision I made. I stand by it. I think it will work very well. But that is just something to be aware of. However, I did not want to waste a whole lot of metal getting power wires all the way down to this one liquid pump. So what I did instead was I set up a much closer source of electricity that is actually only a short distance away from the oil biome. But when a duplicate comes down here and starts running on the manual generator, they tend to stay at the manual generator rather than what duplicates usually do when they go on long commuting trips, which is to come down, pick up one little nugget of resource, and run back to the base. Or they'll come down and they'll dig one little tile and then they'll run back to the base, even though I might have had a bunch of tiles selected to be dug. You know, they'll come down here, they'll say, "Oh gosh, I'm hungry from this long trip," or "I'm tired from this long trip," or "I have other priorities I need to tend to, like ranching critters back at the base or something." So they'll come down, they'll dig one tile out of a queue of dozens, and then they'll turn around and run back to the base. So it's just really annoying trying to do things in situ when your commute is so long. But for the manual generators, once a duplicate comes down and starts running on them, they tend to stay running on the manual generators. So I'm okay with having these things be a little bit closer to the oil biome, because it's not such a waste of time to have a duplicate come down and go running on a generator. So yeah, I decided to do that. I decided to have the manual generators be a little bit closer to the source where their power was actually going to be consumed. And I even took the time to set up some nice decor for them so they don't feel depressed while they're spending hours out of their day running on a generator off in the middle of nowhere. So, yeah. In fact, it got so bad at sometimes during the construction of this insulated pipe and the digging out of the various oil pockets to try to pool the oil into a central pumping location. It got so tedious after a while that I decided to install a door so that when duplicates came running down, I would lock them in there. I would prevent them from turning around and going back. And by forcing them to stay down here, it would encourage them to spend more time taking care of dig jobs before they turned around and ran back to the base. So I would keep them down here until somebody gave the notice up here in the top left corner of the screen that said something like unreachable food. And as soon as I saw the unreachable food notice, I would know that that duplicate's meal shift had come around, these little green bars on the schedule. I would know that a green mealtime schedule had arrived, and I need to come back up to the door and allow those duplicates to go home. So that was the system I ran by, and it allowed me to be much more efficient with my excavations, and I will continue to do that. Okay, so I think what we're going to do in this episode now is install the finishing touches of this infrastructure and start actually producing a little bit of oil. Yeah, so let me check on chat. Oil. Now remember, I said one of the byproducts from the oil refinery is natural gas, which is this orange stuff. And unfortunately, it looks like we got a little bit of a leak. I'm not sure how that happened. That's okay. Now it just so happens that there was already a natural gas geyser in this slime biome, because we are looking at a slime biome, in case you couldn't tell. So there was already a natural gas geyser here in the room. And I decided, you know what, since this thing's going to be outputting natural gas anyway, let me put my other natural gas producing machine in the same airspace with you. And then we can collect that gas with a single pump and distribute it. Now, to prevent the polluted oxygen from coming in and contaminating this pocket of natural gas, I put everything behind a water lock, which is right there. And I've learned from my mistakes that you need to use clean water for these water locks. Or, well, how would I say this? Basically, the only thing you can't use is polluted water, because what polluted water does is it gradually off-gasses. You'll see little green bubbles emerge from the water every once in a while. And that off-gassing process actually reduces the mass of the polluted water. And when the mass gets low enough, the water gate, water lock I should say, I don't want to say water gate on the 4th of July. Anyway, the water lock will eventually dissipate, it'll evaporate into the air if you're using polluted water. So basically the lesson learned is never use polluted water for water locks. You always want to have a clean water or crude oil or some other non-evaporating liquid to sit here on the tile and bridge the gap to prevent gases from flowing back and forth across the corners. Yeah, so there we go. That is all set up to go. I have a bunch of gas reservoirs filled with hot natural gas waiting to go to the generators. The generators output both carbon dioxide and a little bit of polluted water. So the polluted water will drip down out of these little nozzles So I put up some mesh tile beneath them so the water can just free fall. It'll free fall down and splash onto the tile where the polymer press is sitting. And then that splash will basically provide a little bit of passive coolant to the polymer press so that it does not overheat. And then once it spills off of the polymer press's tiles, it will fall back down into here. And eventually I might come along and install a liquid pump to siphon off the excess polluted water that has been generated by the generators. So yeah, that's the long-term plan, but the accumulation from these guys is actually pretty small. It's not a lot of polluted water at all. We're talking grams, not kilograms. 67.5 grams per second, which is very, very, very little. So I'm not expecting these guys to flood the room or anything, is what I'm trying to get at. Alright, let's finish our infrastructure here. Let's put in some power lines, and for this I'm using the conductive wire made out of lead, where the lead comes from the oil biomes, pre-refined. It's pretty awesome. Let me go back down here to the oil biome. If you weren't already aware, we have lead down here in the oil biome, and the lead is a pre-refined metal. You just come down here, dig it out of the ground, and it is ready to go straight into things like conductive wire and automation. So, pretty awesome. Little sporkit here, outputting diddly zombie spores. I actually have no idea what the zombie spores do. I've never messed around with them. I've just decided to leave them alone. I've never messed with a sporkit yet. I probably will someday, but I'm a little bit nervous about what they might do. Right back to our little room here. So let's finish putting in some power. I'm going to want some batteries and some cutoff gates. Where do I want to distribute the power through? Where do I want to do this? I might set up another one of those mutually exclusive battery zones. It might be the easiest thing to do. Yeah, it's not a bad idea. The generators will be... How do I want to think about this? If I'm using conductive wire, I don't need to use transformers because the total wattage of the machines in this room is less than the 2 kilowatt capacity or the 2,000 watt capacity of the conductive wire. So I don't need a transformer anywhere in this system. So I should just be able to get away with having smart batteries alone. That should be sufficient, I think. Let me test that theory. So have duplicates come in and get rid of these guys. Start this over here as a reference. I actually took a screenshot of this earlier for a personal memento, but I forgot where I put the screenshot. Speed up time, of course. Make sure all the ducts are here. Oh, that's right. We need a carbon dioxide output, so I need to have you... Actually, we'll just share. We'll share the output. It'll be fine. Here. You can come down this way. We'll all share the same output. Shouldn't be a problem. And then eventually I'll need to input or install a carbon skimmer, but I'm not too worried about that yet because... As you can see, the polluted oxygen is actually taking over my ladder system, and the polluted oxygen is coming down and merging into where the carbon dioxide used to sit. So actually, if anything, I'd like the carbon dioxide to build up enough that it overspills out of this room and starts reasserting its dominance in the ladder system, the mineshaft system, so that we don't have polluted oxygen going to places where it doesn't belong. Not that it can really do any harm, it's just, it's a tidiness thing. I don't like having polluted oxygen just roaming around. Carbon dioxide is a clean gas. It's not a good gas per se, but it's a clean and safe gas. And I'd rather have these rooms and passageways be filled with carbon dioxide than be filled with polluted oxygen. Now, obviously, I can say that because all my duplicates are wearing exosuits, but if my duplicates were coming in here without exosuits on, then the presence of polluted oxygen would actually be a boon to their ability to breathe. But since they're all using exosuits, I'd rather have carbon dioxide be everywhere. So I'm going to postpone installing the carbon skimmer because we really don't need it right now. Oh, sorry, the other infrastructure you need for the carbon skimmer is the water sieve, because the carbon skimmer will take in clean water, kind of like this. I'll just set this up on the side to give you guys an idea of what it does. Just set this up on the side somewhere. Do a little hop, skip, jump thing. Where can I put this safely? Yeah, that's not a bad spot. Let's put it right there. And then down, I think. I'll just go across. Sure. So clean water goes in, and then polluted water comes out and needs to be put back into the polluted water system to go back to a water sieve and be recycled. The water skimmer neither consumes nor produces water, it just transforms the water. In the same way that the water sieve transforms polluted into clean, the carbon skimmer transforms clean into polluted. So you kind of need these two. These two are sibling systems, and you need both of these buildings together to function properly as a unit. And we are about to get a new thing. I don't have room for any more duplicates, so I guess I'm taking the brine. I'll get that power later. It doesn't need power right now. It's not actually being used. My automation system is to detect the presence of carbon dioxide on two different measurement tiles, and then so long as they both say that they have a detection, they will both output a green to the AND gate, and the AND gate will then pass along that green to the carbon skimmer. But if either one of them has not detected carbon dioxide for a while, it will turn the carbon dioxide, or it'll turn the carbon skimmer off. So it's a double sampling system just to make sure this thing is not active too often. But I don't need it right now because we are pressurizing the upper base, and that'll compress the carbon dioxide in the lower base. And when the carbon dioxide gets compressed, it might actually fall below the upper story mushrooms, and then these mushrooms will be dormant until we get some more carbon dioxide in here or depressurize the upper base once again. It's been a fluctuating system. Balancing the gas pressure in this base between top and bottom has been kind of a pain, kind of a chore, but yeah, we'll deal with it. Okay, so we are ready to set up our batteries. Let's look at where that's going to be. Going through one set of batteries, and then actually, do I even need to do that? Do I even need to have them? Yeah, I think I'm gonna do it. I'd like to make the system have no transformers at all. That would be really nice. So yes, I am gonna split it. I'm gonna have two inputs. Let's try to put them up far to the left over here. Okay, I need to rearrange some things. So let's cut that, and cut that. We'll have the input go through a couple of gates on the bottom. You guys will all contribute. And it looks like I'm gonna need some ladders down here. And then I'll need to get rid of this machine once it's done. Once that battery has been expired, I will. Actually, what is this powering? It's not even doing anything right now. It's literally just powering light bulbs and the gas pump, which can't do anything more because its line is completely full. So you know what? Let's just get rid of that right now. It's not doing anything. Right, this will go up through the batteries into a second gating system, and then go out to the rest of the environment. This will have to cycle back to the polymer press. A little bit unfortunate, but it's safer that way. Okay. I'm going to make these out of gold just because it does tend to get rather warm in these rooms. start installing our AND gate. So I'm going to keep the AND gate a little bit out of the way to the far side of the battery, so you can actually watch the electricity gauge or the charge gauge. Like over here, the AND gate is set a little bit to the side so you can watch the charge meter filling while you're looking at the automation view. Prior to starting the stream, I actually had this AND gate situated one tile to the left, and it was obstructing the view of that power gate, so it wasn't very useful for monitoring. So I decided to move it one tile to the right just to make things a little bit easier on us. And I am going to set a view bookmark on this room with control... let's choose 3, I think. So we have 1 for the base, 2 for the oil biome power generation system, and more importantly, the door that helps me lock the duplicates in here. And 3 is now our oil processing room. Alright, so let's start installing the automation. There, another one right there, a few NOT gates here and there, nothing major, and a bridge if you don't mind. And then everything else should just be wires, I think. I'll just confirm that. Yes, everything else is just wires. Okay, cool. So that is it. 5 gates and a bridge is basically all you need for that little mutually overriding system. Okay, now, I don't want these things to be running all the time, so in addition to cutting off the power contribution, I am also going to need... you know, these batteries aren't even really necessary, strictly speaking, because the wattage output of these things, all 3 of them combined, is 2400 watts, which again is more than the wattage that's going to be in here. So what I could do without worrying about it is just connect everything to the main grid directly. I don't need to have the batteries being in here. I'm just doing the batteries out of habit because I might expand this room eventually. I might have additional circuits in here or additional machinery being in here. It's not a guarantee that these reservoirs will stay here permanently. I may add other machines in this room just to consolidate my heat sources. So, I'm putting in the batteries early just kind of as a precaution of trying to, you know, get a jump on the gun. Or get ahead of the situation that might befall me in the future. So, in addition to segregating the voltage, I also need to control the activation of these generators. And that is going to take, or going to require a different look, because I haven't done something like that in a while, so I need to think about it as I'm doing it. You come from there and go out to there, and you go there. You come down here, and oh, that's right, you go under the bridge. There we go. Okay, done. Now, I need to have the bottom lines, I think, coming out. And if one or the other is on, yes, that's all I need. I just need a basic OR gate. That's all I need. That'll be fine. I'll just get an OR gate in here somewhere. Like, that will be fine. That should work just fine. So you continue to come out here. And then you will output to all the other 3. Okay, that should be enough. Now watch these gates go open or shut as the logic system becomes more complete. They'll keep oscillating, like one will go open, then it'll go shut later on. As all the automation wires are installed and the logic gets worked out across the entire circuit, the gates will keep opening and shutting until they finally reach their ultimate final stable point. Come on, guys. A little bit faster, please. They're probably having to go all the way down to the oil biome just to get the lead, so I really shouldn't complain about the speed. I mean, Devin is just rocking that. Pew! Zap, zap, zap. Guys. Okay, come on, Catalina. Finish it! Ren, I know you can do it! Just two more. Well, three more? Just three more tiles. Come on! Have them sweep up the stuff as well, because I don't want those things being in the way. So here we go. I'm going to have this say all. It's sweep only. Nobody else is allowed to come in here. I believe I already have a few people in here. Yeah, I already have a couple people down here delivering lead. There we go, okay. So I'll let them stay up there. Once they deliver their lead, I will have them do a sweep errand to get these materials out of here. I think that's Harold, actually. It is Harold. Okay, where are you going, buddy? You are going to fill the kiln. Good job. Okay, here. Harold, sweep the stuff by the batteries, please. Come on, buddy. There you go. Good job, guys. Get rid of all the junk there. Unreachable food. So it's these guys' downtime. They've just hit their green bars, so I need to let them go. There we go. All right. You guys are free to return home. Cool. And the stuff is swept. Alright, so there we go. That is the final stable configuration of the gates until we first apply power. And that is going to happen as soon as I provide fuel for the generators. So, let's hook up our output line. And hook up our input lines. Here we go. Oh shoot. crap. whoops. Somebody please come and get rid of that wire so it turns red. I forgot I don't even have the cables hooked up. dang it. Okay, so we should come get that momentarily. Also, you could disable this if you want to. Either or will work fine. Please don't waste all my natural gas. Please don't waste all my natural gas. Somebody come delete that. Thank you. Yeah, but thanks, Bert. You were a little bit late there. Thanks. Okay. Since this is going to be ready momentarily, let me also finally connect my my oil pipes. So we have a full reservoir already, 5 tons of oil sitting in this liquid reservoir, ready to go. And who's starving? Geraldo, calm down. You were just a long way from home. That's no big deal. Alright, so a bunch of oil sitting in the reservoir. It is ready to go up the pipe. And we have one safety break right here. Connected that, and we have another safety break right before the actual oil refinery, and I also have a valve that I could close if need be. This second valve on the left will eventually go up to the cooling system, the steam turbine cooling system, and the crude oil will be diverted to fill up my thermal exchange tank, which I mentioned in the last stream. So it'll be a very large tank. I'm talking like 7 tall by usually 6 wide. Wait, how wide are the... Hang on, momentarily turn on sandbox. Steam turbines are 5 tiles wide, so it's 10 internal. Yeah, so we're talking a 7 by 10 block of digging that needs to take place. So steam turbines coolant exchange tank will look like that. Wait, is it seven or is it more than seven? I think it's just seven. And then we'll have pair of pipes going. Oh shoot. Oh dang it, dang it, dang it. I'll just leave it there. It'll be an Easter egg for somebody to find someday. Whoops. So we'll have a pair of pipes, one in, one out. Two pair of pipes, one in, one out. Three pair of pipes, one in, one out. And then a steam turbine room cooling pipe to siphon back some of its own cooling to keep the turbines themselves cool. And then this whole huge tank will need to be filled with crude oil. That's the size we're talking about. We're talking about 70 tiles worth of crude oil. So it's a lot. But I'll hook that up when the time comes. It's not going to be happening anytime soon. So now, as soon as I draw this final safety connection here, or connect the safety brake, that should allow the oil to start flowing. There we go. Okay, so oil will be here in a couple of minutes. And then, as soon as we finish off this last nugget here of wire, I can turn the system back on. And that means I also have to hook up this side, otherwise, we're not doing much with our power. Thank you, Nisbet. Nisbet's our doctor. I don't know why our doctor is out here doing construction work, but whatever. Thank you. And now, let's reinstall that piece of cable that we emergency deleted. Printables, yay! Brine for us. Getting to be very briny back at the base. Got a lot of brine and not seawater, salt water accumulating in front of the printing pod that we need to process eventually through a desalinator. Okay, cool. There we go. Batteries are charged. Wow, look how fast they charge. My god. So now they're both discharging because the power supply vastly exceeds the power consumption that we have going on here. It's kind of ridiculous. And this natural gas geyser is active for the next 40 and a half cycles. So we have plenty of natural gas to stay going for a long time to come. I will not need to worry about having supplementary power of any kind for a long time. And with enough reservoirs to keep us tidied through until, or not tidied, keep us tided through until the next activity cycle of the geyser, then we would never need to have additional supplementary powers. Okay, there we go. So there's something changing over here. Let's watch the fluids. So the natural gas geysers are dripping polluted water down onto the tiles where the polymer press sits, but the polymer press itself also offputs steam. I did mention I was going to talk about that in the future. Taking notes. Yeah. Oh, the overreactions are great. So the polymer press outputs a tiny little bit of steam, just 8 1/3 grams per batch, basically. 8 1/3 grams per batch. Well, technically it says 8 1/3 per second, and I think what happens is it outputs a substantially larger amount than that, like once per batch. You don't get actually a continuous stream of steam. What you get instead is an accumulation of about 200 grams that just pop out every time you get a batch of plastic. So there's our first little batch of plastic, comes out 30 kilograms at a time. And we'll get a little puff of steam, and steam will almost immediately condense and fall on top of the water down below. Which means. Wait, whoa, whoa, where did you take that plastic? Where did you take that plastic? I saw you run off of that. Where did you just move that? Hang on, hang on. Sorry. They just brought. I know I. Here's the thing. I know I have a storage bin set up to hold industrial ingredients, but until. Oh, is it manufactured? Oh, it's this one. Oh, okay, that's where you brought it. Is the plastic already there? Hang on, let's prevent anybody else from going out. Is the plastic already there? Who's carrying the plastic? Somebody's carrying the plastic. Where did it go? Lyra, are you the guilty party? He's not carrying anything. Where did it go? Oh, hey, here we go. Ren has it. Okay, go ahead, Ren. There we go. Now, let's take that and say, no plastic for you. No plastic for you. I want the plastic to sit right where it is. Okay, so just sit there and accumulate. Now you guys are safe to go back and forth. So yeah, eventually we get an accumulation of clean water floating on top of the polluted water, which is a bit of an annoyance. Well, I'll give you this view. You might see some light blue tiles very briefly appear before they condense and turn into water. That would be the steam coming out of the polymer press. So watch for light blue tiles as it runs out of power. Nope, it condenses so fast we don't even see it. Okay, well, that's too bad for us. Now, the polymer press runs really, really, really hot. If you do not have some sort of a cooling system for this, the polymer press will overheat. But having just a little bit of water sitting on front of it helps to prevent it from overheating. Nonetheless, you do want to use a material like gold amalgam or steel to make sure that this thing doesn't reach critical temperatures, because it's continuing to climb right now, which is not very encouraging. The only time it's getting fresh water is either when it covers itself in its own steam, or when these generators are running and dropping small amounts of fresh material onto it, but it doesn't really suck up a whole lot of heat. Oh, there we go. See, it just dropped back down from red to orange, and now it's going back up toward red. So, yeah, it runs very hot. The polymer press is a huge heat producer, which is why you need to give it some kind of cooling or make it out of steel or thermium or something like that. How are we doing? Carbon dioxide is going out. We're just filling up the room with carbon dioxide. I have no problem with that. I'm going to cheat momentarily and get rid of these annoying little nuggets of orange. Turning on sandbox and basically inputting non-existent amounts of carbon dioxide just to get rid of them, because I don't like that. It annoys my control-ness, my control needs. And here's why I have the mesh tile. If you have all three tiles underneath the polymer press being solids, then what tends to happen is the polymer press gets too much coolant sitting on the ground next to it, and the machine will say that it has been flooded. And then you have to have some poor duplicate come along and sweep up like a couple of grams of liquid to clear one of the three tiles, and then the polymer press will start running again. It's just annoying. So I've gotten into the habit of having at least one of the three tiles be a mesh tile or something where the water can just flow off of to prevent the machine from becoming flooded, even though there's such a small, tiny amount of fluid here to begin with. I'm talking like 33 grams, but whatever. It's just a stupid machine. Okay, so that, I think, just about does it. We have a bunch of crude oil coming up. This is all dependent on... Wait, why is nobody... Why are you saying no power? How do you have no power? You should be charging. Hang on. That shouldn't be happening. Let's force a reset on that. There we go. Nope. Still not working? Come on, guys. Oh, you ran out of gas. Oh, that's what happened. I knew that. There's always something to forget in this game. Always some little detail that you'll overlook. There we go. Okay, now we have power back. As long as we have a duplicate coming in here on a regular basis and producing petroleum for us, these reservoirs will gradually fill up with petroleum, and we can keep our polymer press going for as long as we feel we need to. And now I should have enough plastic on hand that I can actually build a steam turbine without resorting to sandbox cheats. Yeah, so each steam turbine takes 200 kilograms of plastic. So we have that now, and I could build one if I wanted to. I'm not going to build it here. I'm going to build it in the permanent cooling solution room, but that is a more advanced structure, a more advanced room, basically. It's multiple rooms altogether. And you can see it in past oxygen not included content that I've done. I will be making my videos public again soon, but I am not necessarily the best source for all that information. So I'm only going to do a subsequent finale to this tutorial series if somebody actually comes along and asks me to. Otherwise, this will do it. This will actually suffice to be the finale of the stream. Yeah, I think that's it. We're at hour 16. You know what? Let me pull up our little survival guideline. Yeah, give me a second. Let me pull up our survival guideline. Get you back on Oni here. We're just going into cycle 190 now. So we got all this done by cycle 190, before cycle 200. All this done. We have. Sure, YouTube's still seeing this. Anytime now, YouTube. Anytime now, YouTube. Okay, there we go. So we have all the stuff done. We have rooms, we have great halls, nature reserves, washrooms, hospitals, massage clinics, barracks, stables, closed loop gray water system where we'll never ever run out of water as long as we manage that correctly. Self-sufficient, self-powering oxygen production systems for our exosuits. Coolant metal refinery in a likewise closed loop with plenty of standby liquid substance to act as a temperature buffer during any of our changes of producing heat. Loads of water to deal with. No need to go tapping into steam geysers or anything like that for quite a while to come because we have so much clean water on hand. We have mushrooms feeding our duplicants. Everybody's running around being happy. We have generators providing power evenly from one production source to most of the rest of our base. Oh yeah, I never explained why I had a second rock crusher. The reason for the second rock crusher is because its sole job is to process the fossil. The fossil comes from two places. One, which is quite friendly, comes from the saltwater biomes. You will find a fair bit of fossil here in the saltwater biomes. And its temperature is, well, high 30s, mid 40s, something like that. It can get fairly warm, but for the most part, it's at relatively comfortable temperatures. I'm not sure why I have a tile there. So this is down to 34, whereas the other one was up at 49 degrees. It varies depending on what the proximal heat production things are, but we have a water geyser right there, so that's probably why the fossils up here were a bit warmer because that heat seeped out. Anyway, so fossils come from two places, one being the saltwater biomes, and the other place where you're more likely to get it in bulk is down here in the oil biome, where we have long, long tracks of fossil that go on for quite a few tiles. And since the majority of the fossil is very hot, I wanted there to be a safe place outside of my base where those hot fossils could be turned into lime without compromising the interior temperatures of my base. So the interior rock crusher is only processing eggshells, and I guess I could do poke shell molts as well, because those are cool substances to turn into lime. And then the outside rock crusher is fossil to lime, so it prevents heat contamination, basically. So that's what that's about. Yeah, I took some time to train our dedicated digger, who is Harold. You guys remember me torturing him in his little prison cell for many cycles until he recovered from his negative strength trait, and then once he was back up and And back up to fighting strength, he emerged like Rocky after a long winter training and got back into the fight and went on a huge excavation party all the way down to the oil biome, tracing long, long lines of ladders all the way down here. And thanks to Harold, we were able to reach the oil biome and install a liquid pump. And then back up we go. We are now at the stage where we can produce loads of plastic, have lots of natural gas, another self-contained, self-sufficient system. And yeah, that's pretty much the point where we are, and there's not a whole lot else needed for this space. Now, optionally, you could go back into my little cheat sheet here, where I have written down my typical sequence of surviving an oxygen not included asteroid. We looked at the local activities in, I'd want to say, the first one, maybe two streams of this mini tutorial series. Then we focused on the nearby necessities, the last one being building a power grid, which I accomplished by cycle 150. And now we are starting to dip our toes into the remote section where we have oil industry and plastic. The next thing to do with the plastic is to build a steam generator cooling system. This will be the permanent large 70 tiles of crude oil system that I'll install. And then once we have that cooling system, we start putting that cooling system to work, regulating the temperatures throughout all of our usable areas of the base. We're talking inside the base, in the increasingly hot power distribution grid, and eventually into the oxygen production rooms as well. And we might even be able to convert the metal refinery's cooling over to the cooling system from the steam turbines, just because they are that powerful. Once you get the whole system up and running, and the system has taken time to cool itself down, you can then start sending lots of your base's heat to that cooling system, and it will just devour the heat. It is a very powerful system. But it takes time to set up. So once you have your base's temperatures under control, then you start going up to space and going just hog wild with end game activities. But I'm not going to get into those because I've done those in so many past streams. You guys kind of know how that all works, and it's more a period of self-discovery. You know, you kind of want to see how the space industry works. I think it's more rewarding to feel the frustration of trying to survive in space, realizing that being on top of the asteroid is a much different animal than being down safely inside the asteroid. So I'm not going to do a tutorial on space because space is very subjective. How everybody deals with space is quite different, and I don't think there's a whole lot of utility in doing a tutorial on that segment of gameplay. So yeah. Oh, and then you can use cold water from the cooling system to make better crops. Okay, so a final word on crops. Mushrooms will last you for a super long time on any asteroid where you have an abundance of slime. And on this particular asteroid, we do have an abundance of slime kind of all over the place. It's pretty much everywhere. We're not going to run out for a long time to come. However, as the job board becomes fuller and I start assigning more and more tasks to my duplicates, they are going to need more green than orange. They're going to need a lot more green. And the best way to give them more green morale is to give them high morale foods. And the high morale foods come from recipes that go beyond what the mushrooms can accommodate. So if I were to just casually delete this grill and briefly but temporarily install a gas range in its place, we can take a look at some of those advanced recipes. So, advanced recipes include stuffed berry, which needs crystal berry and pinch of peppernut. Both of these are plants that require thermal regulation. Mushroom wraps takes our beloved fried mushrooms, which come not directly from the dust cap, but actually go from the dust cap through the grill and then into the gas range. And it also takes lettuce, where lettuce comes from the saltwater biomes. Then you have surf and turf, which is barbecue cooked fish. That's basically just killing off critters. Pepper bread comes from pinch of peppernut and sleet wheat grain. Both of these are also thermally regulated plants. Spicy tofu we can't make on this asteroid because we do not have Nosh sprout beans. Those only exist in the rust biomes, and we don't have any rust biomes on Terra. But again, these are also temperature regulated plants. Pinch pepper not needing lots of heat, and tofu or Nosh sprout needing lots of cold. And Frostburger, which again goes back to lettuce, which needs to grow in the salt water biomes. Frostbun, which comes from the grill's processing of sleet wheat, where sleet wheat comes from the ice biomes. So basically, almost every single high morale recipe that comes from the gas range requires that you invest in thermally regulated crops. You need to have temperature controlled plants for long-term survival and also for high morale, so that your duplicants continue doing the many jobs that you're assigning to them without them becoming depressed and blowing a gasket. So that's what we need to head toward eventually, and the only way to do that is to build a giant cooling system so that we can have some sort of an agricultural zone that is filled with carefully regulated air-conditioned units for growing bristle blossom or sleet weed or whatever else we feel like growing. So yeah, that's survival of oxygen not included in a nutshell. Yeah. Rocky. All right, so there we go. Hour and a half. I think that's going to do it for me. Thanks very much, guys. If you have any questions, leave them in comments. I can do little mini videos addressing specific issues. Decor. Go for decor. Get lots and lots of good decor. I think that's going to do it. I will only do a follow-up on my plans for the cooling system once it's fully built if somebody leaves a comment asking me to. Otherwise, just consider that an implicit thing. You can go check out other YouTube content that cover those things in detail. One channel that did a really good video on it was called Gearhead Gaming, I want to say. So look for Gearhead Gaming Steam Turbines, and there should be a 30-something minute video in which he details pretty much every aspect of how the system works. I had to watch his video like half a dozen times to understand every aspect of it, because he doesn't explain all of the math that goes into it, or if he does explain the math, a lot of the times he explains it in a way that makes sense to his head, not to my head, and I had to actually build the machine and discover for myself what its ratios are of steam processing and heat consumption and all that stuff. I actually had to see it and measure it for myself in game just to kind of get a sense of what he was talking about in his video. So he goes into a lot of detail, but it is a very good video. So you guys can check that out, or just ask me to show it to you when I'm done building it. And yeah, but that's gonna do it for now. Thanks for watching, folks, and I'll see you next time.